The subcommittee will come to order. After recognizing myself and ranking member Mr. Deutsch for Florida for 5 minutes each for our opening statements, I will then recognize other members seeking recognition for 1 minute. We will then hear from our witnesses, and your prepared statements without objection will be made a part of the record, and members may have 5 days to insert statements and questions for the record, subject to the length limitation in the rules. And the chair now recognizes herself for 5 minutes. Egypt has always been of central importance to the Middle East and the region's stability. It has also been a strategic interest for the United States, our policy objectives in the region, and our national security. The Suez Canal remains an all-important waterway that serves as a strategic asset for the global trade, but just as importantly, the avenue which U.S. warships can easily traverse to go between the Mediterranean and the Persian Gulf. Over the past 4 years, we have certainly seen Egypt undergo drastic changes. As policymakers, we face one of the more difficult challenges in Egypt, and today's hearing is entitled Egypt, 2 years after Morsi, to examine the ever-changing dynamics on the ground of that country. Since the 2011 revolution, the change we had hoped to see for Egypt has been slow to come, to say the least. For many of us, myself included, we believe that human rights is a top priority that must be taken into account as we formulate our foreign policy objective. We want to see people living in free, democratic, and open societies where everyone can practice without fear their religion and where everyone is treated equally and fairly. In March of this year, an Egyptian court ruled that parliamentary elections had to be postponed, marking a major setback in Egypt's path to democracy. The authorities in Egypt and different branches of government must work together to ensure that the elections are scheduled as quickly as possible and in accordance with Egyptian law. It's important to note that elections for the sake of elections are not the only requirement for a democracy. A government must also govern democratically and respect the rights of its citizens. But we also understand that there can be no economic prosperity, no political stability without safety and security. And right now, Egypt faces threats from the Sinai and along its borders with Libya. And Cairo plays an important role as a counterbalance to the Iranian regime's hegemonic ambitions in the region. Egypt has taken a very active role in the Sinai, which for years has been ignored by Cairo, and is confronting the radical terror groups, some affiliated to ISIL. Egypt has long been a vital, Egypt has also been vital in cutting off and destroying the tunnels in Gaza used by Hamas, and has been working closely with Israel to combat their shared threats. Earlier this year, the administration decided to resume weapons transfer to Egypt to help Cairo counter some of these threats. In 2013, Mr. Connolly and I commissioned a three-phase report from the Government Accountability Office to assess our foreign assistance to Egypt. The GAO is currently conducting this third phase, which will assess the security-related assistance, and the timing could not be more important as we resume these weapon sales. It is in our national security interest to see that these terror threats are eliminated and that Egypt remains a strategic ally and continues to have a good working relationship with Israel. Recently, Egypt has taken moves that signal that it is willing to move away from the U.S. toward a closer relationship with Russia. Russia has agreed to build a nuclear power plant in Egypt, and the two have increased trade dramatically over the past year, and Putin has vowed to increase Russian weapons sales to Egypt. We cannot afford to allow Putin to undermine our ties with Egypt. It would be a serious blow to our national security interests. But as friends, it is also important that we take issue with Cairo's lack of progress on the domestic front. I still remain deeply concerned over the fate of 43 NGO workers, many of whom are American citizens who were convicted in absentia in a sham, politically motivated trial. It would be a simple but important gesture for Sisi to pardon these individuals and signal that he is willing to move Egypt forward in a positive direction and could improve the U.S.-Egypt bilateral relationship. We should also look to re-examine the controversial laws against civil society, like the NGO law and the protest law. As much as the Egyptian people appreciate safety, security, and economic growth after the recent instability, they are also seeking far-reaching changes to the political process and the people's relationship with the state. President Sisi should seize this opportunity to move forward on long-needed democratic reforms, and the U.S. can play an important role in that effort. What it boils down to is finding the right balance between security and democracy, and the United States must ensure that we leverage our assistance to promote both simultaneously. With that, I'm pleased to yield to the ranking member of our subcommittee, Mr. Deutsch.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. This hearing was intended to give members of this subcommittee the opportunity to take a broad look at the issues affecting Egypt today and the U.S.-Egypt relationship. I'd like to take a moment to thank the chairman and my colleague, Mr. Connolly, who have been extremely focused on bringing justice to those 43 NGO workers who have still not been pardoned, including our witness here today, Dr. O'Kale. We must continue to press for this justice. Since the overthrow of Mubarak, there have been differing opinions on Capitol Hill as to how we should approach Egypt. But I think we all agree that Egypt plays a critical role in a very volatile region, and it is and should continue to be an important partner of the United States. We want to see Egypt succeed economically, and we want to see long-term stability and safety. In 2011, the people of Egypt bravely took to the streets to seek freedoms and rights long denied under the autocratic rule of Mubarak. We were under no illusions then that this transition would be easy. We could not then, and we cannot now, expect Egyptian democracy to look like ours overnight. The subsequent election of Mohamed Morsi in 2012 was significant, but it was Morsi's government who chose to jam through a new constitution with exceptional executive authority. It was Morsi's government that failed to make tough economic choices, like reducing government subsidies to meet IMF requirements that would put the country back on a path to prosperity. And it was Morsi's government who restricted the political space, cutting out those who sought to bring real democratic values to Egypt. So in the summer of 2013, the people of Egypt again took to the streets to protest the barely year-old government, setting in motion the rise of the well-known military commander, General al-Sisi. After another year of transition and interim government, the country held its second presidential election in 2 years, electing the long-respected general. For many, the election of President Sisi represented a return to normalcy. The Sisi government seemed to understand the need to return economic investment to Egypt and to strengthen the country's regional ties. The Gulf states infused Egypt with billions of dollars with hopes of cementing the new government as a stabilizing force. A recent IMF review found that the Egyptian economy has begun to grow, and I was pleased to see the successful results of the Economic Investment Conference in March, which yielded some $60 billion in investment pledges. I urge the government to continue to take the tough steps needed to restore Egypt's financial stability and to bring relief to the people. Many of us here in Washington have also welcomed President Sisi's commitment to security issues. The government has faced the daunting challenge of policing the Sinai, which had become virtually lawless in the years after Mubarak. President Sisi made clear that he would continue close cooperation with Israel's military to prevent terror groups from exploiting this region. These efforts have come at great cost to the Egyptian military, and we are grateful for them. President Sisi has been committed to stopping Hamas from building and using terror tunnels to smuggle weapons into Gaza. The government has destroyed hundreds of tunnels, and in a speech last week, President Sisi estimated his forces have destroyed 80% of these tunnels. Egypt is also facing great challenges on its borders with Sudan and Libya, as these countries become havens for terror training and weapons transit. We all mourn the victims of the gruesome attack on Egyptian Christians by ISIS affiliates in Libya. And I, too, am greatly concerned about Libya's potential to descend into greater chaos, but military action could potentially provoke even greater internal instability. Nevertheless, I agree with our Egyptian partners that the international community must play a role in getting Libya back on track, and I appreciate Egypt's close cooperation with its neighbors as they seek to address regional threats as a regional bloc. I believe the United States must continue to support Egypt, and I support continued assistance. But I am pleased to see our administration moving forward with a rebalance of our aid relationship that will allow Egypt to better address the most pressing threats and continue to cooperate with the U.S. in significant areas like counterterrorism. But like many friends of Egypt, I'm concerned about the erosion of civil society and human rights in the name of security. Regardless of who sits in power, the United States should be delivering the same message to every government leader. And the message is clear. Human rights matter. I'm concerned that too many restrictions have been placed on free expression. I'm concerned about the arrests of journalists and about religious freedom. And I'm concerned about laws that restrict the work of civil society actors or prevent any form of peaceful assembly. There must be a way to balance necessary security measures while protecting and enhancing the basic freedoms of the people of Egypt. This includes fostering good governance, rule of law, and routing out corruption and accountability for security services and government actors. And I have to say, I was particularly dismayed this week to see media reports of rampant sexual abuse by police and security services. I'm also concerned about the impact of mass arrests and the handing down of mass death sentences. I hope our witnesses can speak to the message that this sends to society. And I also hope to hear from our witnesses their thoughts on the death sentence handed down on Monday to Morsi and how it has been received by the Egyptian people. As I've said, I believe in a strong Egypt and a strong U.S.-Egypt partnership. I want to see Egypt move forward on a path to stability and democracy, but even the closest of friends must be able to share and work through concerns. Today, I look to our witnesses to help us understand how we can balance and strengthen this relationship and ensure a successful future for all of the people of Egypt. And I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deutsch. I'm now pleased to yield to other members for their opening statements. Mr. Rohrbacher of California.
Thank you very much for holding this hearing today. What happens in Egypt will determine the future, not only of the Middle East, but of the world. And we need to understand that. If Egypt falls under the control of the radical Islamic forces that now threaten that region, what we will have is the Gulf countries, one by one, will fall like leaves from a tree as the whole dynamic of that region will change. Radical Islam will then thrust itself into Central Asia, and within a short time, we will have a monstrous threat to Western civilization, an historic change, sea change, that could, for many years, put us into a situation of danger and a dark future. There's only one person and one regime and one government that stands in the way of that, and that's President El-Sisi of Egypt. We owe him and the people of Egypt our utmost support to prevent this horrible scenario for the rest of the world and the rest of that region. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Rohrbacher. Mr. Connolly.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Timely hearing, and glad we were able to collaborate on a report in terms of the status of U.S. aid. The fact of the matter is a coup occurred in Egypt, and the United States government has yet formally to acknowledge that because of the consequences under the law. The military alliance with Egypt is a very important one, and I understand the putting a certain primacy on that, but we've paid a price for it. So have the Egyptian people with respect to rule of law, with respect to civic engagement, with respect to the need to create political space. As the current Egyptian government moves forward, hopefully we can make progress on all of those areas. If we don't, the crackdown that has occurred is going to lead to a backlash that will lead us we don't know where, but certainly we won't like it, and probably will have consequences far beyond current consequences of the military government. So I'm looking forward to hearing the testimony today and where we are in terms of these areas with the current Egyptian government. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Meadows.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank you each for your testimony here today. We look forward to hearing it. I apologize. I'm going to have to step out back and forth, but we are monitoring this. I think it's critical that we are here today making great progress. Ambassador Tafik is a good friend here that I consider him a personal friend. And in both the good and the bad times, we have talked about the progress that is being made in Egypt. It is imperative that the American people know that we stand by the Egyptians wanting to govern Egypt. And it is not America wanting to impose its values on Egypt, but it is also critical that Egypt stands so strong in a very tough neighborhood to really add that stability. And so I look forward to hearing your testimony, look forward to working with the Egyptian people in bringing not only the rule of law back front and center, but certainly investments from the United States to continue to flow back to Egypt. Thank you, Madam Chair. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Meadows. Mr. Cicilline.
Thank you, Chairman and Ranking Member, for calling this very timely hearing on Egypt after Morsi, and thank you to our witnesses for being here today. My view is that the post-Morsi description only gets at part of the equation in Egypt. The Egyptian people have experienced an incredible amount of disruption, chaos, and change over the past 4 years. They are living in a post-Mubarak, post-revolutionary, and post-Morsi era. And today they're living under a regime that is perhaps most aptly described as Mubarak 2.0, turning to repression in the name of security. However, there are some significant differences between the landscape now and Egypt under Mubarak. Waves of unrest have left the Middle East in utter chaos, have an increased terrorist attacks and flow of refugees in Egypt. The United States has watched as two successive governments were toppled and is now reevaluating some of its long-standing policies towards the Egyptian government. But most importantly, the Egyptian people have seen what they can do. They've experienced what they can achieve when they stand together in support of human rights and democratic freedoms against a tyrannical regime. And I think the question we need to ask is whether the Egyptian people, who have won and lost so much over the past 4 years, are willing to live under a regime that resorts to the same old tactics of intimidation, repression, and violence against their own people in the name of security. I think ultimately they are not, and that our policies toward Egypt need to reflect not just a security relationship, which is vitally important, but also the reality that the model of supporting an autocratic regime is inherently unstable in the long term. We absolutely must push the Sisi regime to enact democratic reforms and respectful fundamental human rights, and I fear that Egypt will find itself once again in the midst of volatile leadership change if we do not. Thank you for the witnesses for being here today, and I look forward to your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Cicilline. Mr. Trott.
I want to thank the chairwoman and ranking member for holding this timely and critical hearing, and to the witnesses, thank you for taking your time to share your insight on the state of Egypt. I'm from Southeast Michigan, and I'm proud to represent a large and vibrant Coptic community. It's a church with a long history, but it often seems that their interests and concerns since the 2011 uprising have gone unnoticed, if not completely ignored. While the Copts have been largely in peril since St. Mark brought Christianity to Egypt over 2,000 years ago, the 2011 revolution brought renewed hopes of freedom, tolerance, and more prominent participation in public life. As we've seen through various governments that have each had control over Egypt since Mubarak's downfall, the Copts continue to be marginalized or used as a political tool. Sectarian conflicts in rural areas often lead to government-controlled reconciliation sessions, which tend to leave the victims with no justice and the defendant with no more than a slap on the wrist. Under Morsi's regime, the Copts were subject to blatant sectarian rhetoric, inaction by state security, and even an attack by state security forces on the Coptic cathedral. Subsequently, after Morsi's overthrow, there was what could only be described as an unprecedented coordinated attacks on numerous Coptic Christian institutions. And what could only be viewed as a series of positive developments, President Sisi promised to repair and rebuild numerous Coptic churches and recently called for a religious revolution. Today, I look forward to hearing from my colleagues and the esteemed witnesses on how the Copts are faring under President Sisi and the current state of U.S.-Egypt relations. Thank you for your time today.
Excellent statements from all members. And now we'd like to introduce our panelists. First, we welcome Dr. Eric Traeger, who is currently the Esther K. Wagner Fellow at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy. Dr. Traeger is an expert on Egyptian politics and has taught at the University of Michigan. Go Blue. At the University of Pennsylvania. Welcome, Dr. Traeger. Second, we welcome Mr. Samuel Tedros, who is a senior fellow at the Hudson Institute Center for Religious Freedom. Previously, he was a senior partner at the Egyptian Union of Liberal Youth and a lecturer at the School of Advanced Studies at Johns Hopkins University. Welcome. And last but certainly not least, we welcome Dr. Nancy O'Kale. Dr. O'Kale is the executive director of the Tahrir Institute for Middle East Policy and has 12 years experience promoting democracy and development in the Middle East and North Africa. And as we've heard, she's quite active in promoting peace and democracy in Egypt. Prior to joining the Tahrir Institute, she served as a director of the Egypt program at Freedom House and is one of the 43 defendants convicted and sentenced to prison in the political trial of the NGO workers in Egypt. So we welcome you as well, Doctor. And we'll begin with you, Dr. Traeger.
Madam Chair, Ranking Member Deutsch, it's a privilege to be here again before this subcommittee and to sit on this very distinguished panel. Nearly 2 years ago, on June 30th, 2013, unprecedented millions of protesters turned out across Egypt to demand President Mohamed Morsi's ouster. While Morsi, a Muslim Brotherhood leader, narrowly won the June 2012 presidential elections, he rapidly lost support. Morsi's assertion of total power through a November 2012 edict alienated a substantial cross-section of the Egyptian public, igniting demonstrations that continued for months. Then, as the economy plummeted and the tide of popular opinion shifted further against Morsi, Egypt's state institutions mutinied. As a result, the Egyptian state was on the brink of collapse. Meanwhile, rather than offering a political compromise, the Muslim Brotherhood mobilized thousands of its cadres to defend Morsi's presidency and indicated that it would use violence if necessary. This is the context in which Egypt's military, led by then Defense Minister Abdel Fattah al-Sisi, removed Morsi from power. Egypt was on the verge of severe civil strife, if not civil war, and many Egyptians feared that their country was headed the way of Syria or Libya. Yet the manner of Morsi's ouster had significant consequences for Egypt's democratic prospects. By toppling Morsi, the Egyptian military locked itself in a kill or be killed struggle with the Brotherhood. The generals believed that they must destroy the Brotherhood or risk the Brotherhood remobilizing and seeking vengeance. And this fear is hardly theoretical. The Brotherhood openly calls for President Sisi's death, and it released a statement in January calling for jihad and martyrdom in fighting the regime. As a result, the post-Morsi period is perhaps the most brutal in Egypt's contemporary history. Over 2,500 people have been killed and over 16,000 have been detained. These developments are quite dispiriting for those who hoped that the Arab Spring represented the dawn of a more democratic era in the Arab world. But at the same time, Washington should be realistic. It cannot influence Egypt in a more democratic direction so long as the government and the Muslim Brotherhood are locked in an existential struggle with each other. To be sure, the administration has tried to influence Egypt's political trajectory. In October 2013, the administration withheld most of the $1.3 billion in annual military aid to Egypt, quote, pending credible progress towards an inclusive, democratically elected civilian government, end quote. This was a lose-lose proposition. Withholding military aid had no impact on Egypt's authoritarianism. And at the same time, it soured the strategic relationship between Washington and Cairo in ways that have been mentioned earlier today. For this reason, the administration reversed its policy in March and resumed the aid. It's not in Washington's interest to have tense relations with Cairo. After all, Egypt is an important strategic partner. It coordinates with Washington on a wide range of regional activities and has maintained a peace treaty with Israel since 1979. Washington relies on Egypt to grant preferred access in the Suez Canal and overflight rights to equip U.S. military bases in the Persian Gulf and to support the current efforts against ISIS. President Sisi is also far more aligned with U.S. interests than Morsi. First, Egypt is once again a strategic partner against Iran. Whereas Morsi was the first Egyptian president to visit Tehran since 1979, President Sisi has deployed the Egyptian Navy against the Iranian-backed Houthis in Yemen and expelled the Iranian ambassador. As the administration seeks a nuclear arrangement with Iran, strengthening the U.S.-Egypt relationship can help reassure Washington's allies in the Persian Gulf. Second, Egypt is now aggressively battling jihadists in the Sinai. After refusing to act for many years, the Egyptian military launched a major operation in September 2013 against the jihadists, some of whom now affiliate with ISIS. Third, Egypt's relationship with Israel has never been stronger. Whereas Morsi refused to establish a channel between his presidential office and the Israeli government, President Sisi communicates openly and directly with his Israeli counterpart. There is also unprecedented Egyptian-Israeli coordination on the Sinai. Fourth, Egypt is now constraining rather than aiding Hamas, which is a U.S.-designated terrorist organization. Indeed, whereas Morsi welcomed Hamas officials to the presidential palace in Cairo, the Sisi government has shut down Hamas's Cairo suburban headquarters. In closing, the proper policy towards Egypt is for Washington to cooperate with Cairo on regional strategy, but not condone its repressiveness. If Washington doesn't draw this distinction, If it instead conditions its relationship with Cairo on its progress towards democracy, the strategic relationship will suffer without any positive impact on Egypt's domestic politics. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much. Mr. Tedros?
Madam Chairman, Ranking Member Deutsch, distinguished members of the committee, thank you for holding this important hearing and for inviting me to testify today. For the past 4.5 years and after decades of political stagnation, the foundations of the political order in Egypt were shaken to their core as the country's citizens struggled with questions of democracy, the rule of law, and the country's identity. In July 2013, following popular protests, the military removed President Morsi from power, promising the Egyptian people not only to bring about stability and security, but also equal citizenship and prosperity. Those hopes are today on the shoulder of President Sisi following his elections. While Egypt faces numerous challenges, security, economic, and political, I will focus in my testimony on religious freedom questions, the rule of law. I would be happy to address other aspects of Egypt's challenges in the Q&A. On the 26th of March 2015, a mob gathered in the village of El Gala in Minya Governorate and began attacking Christian homes and shops. The mob was incensed that Christians had received a permit to build a church in the village. Instead of protecting the Christians from that attack, the security forces allowed the attack to take place, and after the attack was concluded, held a reconciliation session between the elders of both communities to see how the situation can be calmed. The result was a number of demands by the mob. The church that was to be built would have no dome, no cross, no tower, no bell, and its entrance was to be on a side street, i.e., it should have no outer manifestation of Christianity. The security forces forced cops to accept those demands in order for the church to be built, despite cops having the necessary permits for their church. The mob then continued its attack, demanding further that cops who had spread news of the attack in the local and international press would publish an apology for those attacking them for tarnishing the image of the village Muslim residents. Again, those attacks went unpunished, with the regime arresting an equal number from those attacked and attacking in order to hold a reconciliation session, again to force reconciliation between them without implementation of the rule of law. Until today, this church has not been built. This is unfortunately not an isolated incident. Similar incidents have taken place in the village of Al-Ur, which represents where 13 of those Copts that were beheaded by ISIS in Libya come from. While President Sisi promised to build a church in that village, after protests by the residents in that village, the location of that church was to be moved to the outskirts of the village instead of inside. Similarly, we've seen the continuation of blasphemy accusations and trials under President Sisi. Those have included a number of Christians, Shiites, that have been arrested for simply praying or for the possession of Shiite books. That is considered a crime that has led to six months for a Shiite person in prison. Similarly, atheists have received sentences from 1 to 3 years for simply posting their views and their beliefs on Facebook. Despite the Egyptian government undertaking a number of symbolic steps towards religious freedom, including President Sisi's call for a religious revolution and his visit to the Coptic Cathedral, it has failed to implement the rule of law, protect the country's most vulnerable citizens from those attacks taking place. The basis of the Egyptian-American relationship has been since 1974, following former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger's visit, that Egypt would become a regional player in the side of the United States, that it would play a leading role in the peace process, in leading the whole region to peace with Israel and to stability and prosperity. For the past 30 years, that relationship has held. Egypt, despite disagreements with the United States, played an important role in the peace process, in the defeat of Saddam's invasion of Kuwait and in a host of other issues. Yet the Egypt of today is no longer the Egypt of the past. Egypt is no longer a regional player that can lead the region to anything, but instead is a playfield itself, with a host of international, local, and regional powers competing for the country's future trajectory. The United States needs to base its relationship with Egypt not on the dreams of an Egypt that no longer exists, but instead on the reality that no one wants an Egypt that looks like Somalia. No one wants a Somalia on the Nile. No one wants a Libya bordering Israel, and no one wants a Syria in control of the Suez Canal. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Okayo.
Chairman Ros-Lehtinen, Ranking Member Deutsch, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for holding this timely hearing. It's an honor to be here. Over the past 4 years, Egypt has experienced several waves of instability that have prevented tangible reforms. Unfortunately, in the minds of many, the situation reinforced a false dichotomy between security and economic stability on one hand and democracy and human rights on the other hand. This also enhanced the view that foreign policy towards Egypt can be viewed in isolation from its domestic affairs. I would like to take this opportunity to clarify the current situation in Egypt and how the U.S. can provide effective support to address it. We must acknowledge the necessity of the recent U.S. decision to overhaul its aid relationship with Egypt in a way that more appropriately focuses on security and terrorism. However, any assistance provided for these purposes must have rights and good governance as its cornerstone. Otherwise, policies are neither effective nor sustainable. In 2012, Egypt saw 41 attacks of terror. This year alone, the number has already surpassed 500 attacks. These acts target police, judges, businesses, and increasingly civilians. Some of these acts occur because of domestic motivations, and others are linked to transnational extremism. In November of 2014, a domestic terror group in Sinai, Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis, was welcomed by Islamic State leader Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi as a new province in the so-called Islamic State. In the Western Desert region, Egypt's porous border with Libya has caused significant security problems for the country, allowing free flows of arms and, in some cases, militants in and out of Egypt. Terror groups continue to successfully expand online, spreading their propaganda and recruiting new members. Many Egyptians have traveled to fight under the Islamic State banner in Iraq, Syria, and Libya, and it's unknown how many have returned home. Evidently, terror threats are on the rise and require all supports from Egypt's partners. However, the current approach of sweeping arrests, large-scale military campaigns in Sinai, and restrictions on rights and freedom will not be effective in identifying the actual threats. Physical and cyber threats should not prompt policies of increased surveillance and restrictions of freedom of expression, but rather require more open and alternative secular narratives to those of the extremist groups. Stability cannot occur without accountability and security sector reform. Pervasive evidence of torture, expedited trials, and mass sentencing impede the ability of effective investigation and prosecute legitimate terrorism. Egypt should repeal repressive laws and encourage legal training that will fairly consider the rights of all to due process. Currently, the political space is highly restricted. Egypt has been functioning for long without an elected legislature, and still no date has yet been set for the parliamentary elections. If the political and public spheres remain closed, people will have no channel for peaceful engagement, and those with grievances will have no recourse or only violent recourse to communicate their messages. The current controversial demonstration law severely restricts Egypt's rights to peaceful assembly. Among those who have been arrested under the law are prominent activists and peaceful human rights defenders, including Ala Abdel Fattah, Ahmed Meher, Doma, Yara Salem, Sana Saif, and so many. All those committed to transparency and democracy and detained under these laws must be released. Egyptian civil society remained under threat. As you may know, I and 42 others received sentences of 1 to 5 years in prison for our work promoting democracy. Since this time, Proposed drafts for the NGO law have become more restrictive. Many Egyptians are now in the same position as I am, living in exile, separated from our families, and unable to go back to our country without fear of serving years in prison. Such intimidation must stop, and the laws must be amended to civil society actors to engage in their important work and receive necessary support from international counterparts. By recognizing that there can be no security without rights and no safety without democratic development, the United States has a unique opportunity to support Egypt in restoring its stability in its effective and sustainable way. Specific recommendations for Congress could be found in my written testimony. Thank you so much, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you so much. Thank you to all of our panelists for great testimony. Egypt is strategically important for the stability of the region, for helping to contain Iran's push for regional dominance, and for helping counter the terror threats that are coming from Sinai and Libya. However, many Egyptians have viewed the United States negatively since they see the Obama administration as having supported Morsi and the Muslim Brotherhood. During the year and a half when the administration remained on the fence about what to do with its Egypt policy, Cairo received billions from its Gulf allies and signed massive arms deals with Russia and with France. So, Dr. Traeger, what does this mean for our relationship and our leverage with Cairo? What does it mean for our long-term national security interests if Egypt and others move away from the United States toward Russia, toward other countries? And as we've heard, terror attacks have increased rapidly in Egypt in the past 2 years. To what do you attribute this rise, and how can Cairo improve its counterterrorism operations, and who are the groups, what are their goals?
So our leverage with Cairo as it pertains to shaping their domestic politics, I think, is very, very limited due to the domestic struggle within that country, the kill or be killed dynamic that's really defined the politics of the post-Morsi era. And when we tried to shape that by withholding military aid or much of the military aid, as you said, you know, Egypt gravitated towards Russia, signed a preliminary arms deal with Russia, $3.5 billion, and also signed a $5.4 billion deal with France. And that suggests that this idea within Washington that Egypt won't have other options, needs us, and will therefore respond to U.S. pressure as it pertains to its domestic political situation just isn't true. And I think we should learn from the experience of the previous 2 years in which we tried to use the military aid as a stick, and Egypt simply went a different direction. And for sure, if Egypt gravitates more towards Russia or gravitates towards other powers for its military aid, that will make it even more difficult for the United States to shape what it has to shape, which is Egypt's foreign relations and Egypt's external policies. Now, the rise in terrorism within Egypt, especially since Morsi's ouster, I think is attributable to many different things. First of all, Morsi took a pretty light hand in the Sinai. The theory of the Muslim Brotherhood was that by winning power through elections and working to implement the Sharia, which is the Brotherhood's long-term goal, they would convince Sinai jihadis to lay down their arms and adopt the Muslim Brotherhood's path to power. And in former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton's memoirs, she recounts a conversation with President Morsi in which he said that basically there would be no Sinai attacks under an Islamist president, which clearly was not true. So part of it is the light hand that Morsi took in the Sinai, and the fact that after Morsi was ousted, the jihadis feared the return of the security state to Sinai, and then there was an uptick in violence that spread west across the Suez Canal with major attacks in some of the major Egyptian cities, particularly a massive attack in Mansoura, I believe in December 2013. The other aspect of the recent attacks seems to be the role of Muslim Brotherhood youths been slowly gravitating towards a more aggressive posture vis-a-vis the regime. These tend to not be the mass-scale attacks. They tend to be IED attacks, attacks on infrastructure, attacks on police stations. It does not seem to me that the Brotherhood has made that decision to attack civilians, and there's actually a very interesting paper written by the former vice chair of the Muslim Brotherhood's political party to this effect that I'd be happy to share with the committee. Now, I need to hedge a little bit and say that, look, we don't have ironclad proof that this is the Muslim Brotherhood or these are Muslim Brothers. The evidence is circumstantial, but is reflected in Facebook postings and in various interviews that I've had since Morsi's ouster. And the unfortunate thing is, if it's the case, as I frankly believe it is, that the Muslim Brotherhood is involved in these sort of low-profile attacks, that's going to be very hard for the current regime to reverse in sort of a negotiated way, because the conflict between the current government and the Brotherhood is existential. There's really no room for compromise between the two. So, you know, my expectation is that Egypt is going to have a very difficult path moving forward. And just one final point, that the ultimate effect of these attacks and the ultimate effect of the declining security situation seems to reinforce support for Sisi. And this repressiveness that we've been discussing today, you know, has some significant societal support as a result of both the local context and the regional context. Thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. O'Kale, as we know, Egypt has constitutional and international obligations to hold parliamentary elections, which you were talking about, and you pointed out they've been postponed, they've been delayed for too long now. And last month, Sisi declared that these elections would not happen before Ramadan, which begins next month, so another delay. You point out that these elections could open the political space for all, but there are now some beginning steps of political actors who emerged after the 2011 revolution, but they're running out of resources. What indications do we have now that there are political groups and players who can organize, who can have the capability to not only win an election and form parties, but to govern effectively and in a manner that would be free and fair and representative of all the needs of the Egyptian people?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I do believe that there are actually new players in the political field in Egypt. And there are several political parties that started to be, organized and shaped after the revolution. However, as you rightly point out, that they are running out of resources and they're being restricted. The elections would allow this opportunity of the people to be encouraged to actually engage in a real, channels into political participation. However, we must look at the overall environment. In order for these political parties to campaign freely, to actually voice their own agendas and their programs and their aspirations for Egypt, they have to have an ability to voice their demands through peaceful channels, like, for example, having a free media, which is currently suffering a lot of restrictions. At the same time, we should have also independent organizations that would monitor and oversee these processes, which is basically civil society organizations who are currently under restriction because of the current NGO law and the drafts that's been proposed for these organizations to function under a new law has been equally restrictive. In addition, there was also a new amendment of in the penal code that would penalize and criminalize anyone who would receive funding from foreign sources that would, using a language that is very loose, saying just threaten national security without saying or identifying what would be actually determined and identified as a threat to national security. All this put all the players, whether the political actors, the political parties as organized entities, and also analysts and media and civil society actors under threat and in a limbo and acting under intimidation, which would not be conducive for a real environment for an effective elections. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Deutsch is recognized for his questions.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I'd throw this out to the panel. Mr. Tatters, you I made yourself clear that you don't believe that at this point, if I understood you correctly, that Egypt can be a leader in the Arab world. It's to the contrary, I think, is how you explained it. I would just like the panel to look out over the next year or two and tell us where you think things are going. We speak in, we focus on different silos, on security issues, on human rights issues, and civil society, but they all ultimately impact not just the people of Egypt, but they impact the ability of Egypt to be a leader in the Arab world. They impact the relationship between Egypt and the United States. So what will things look like a year or two out, and to what extent does there necessarily need to be progress on all of these areas for Egypt to be a leader in the Arab world? And do we need to see the same advances for the relationship between Egypt and the United States to be strengthened?
I am indeed making the case that the Egypt with which Dr. Kissinger forged a lasting relationship with the United States is no longer there. The Egypt that was ruled by President Anwar Sadat in 1974, when he first met with Dr. Kissinger, was an Egypt that was the cultural leader of the Arab world, that its influence ranged from the Morocco to Iraq. It could influence the decisions of the regimes there and lead the region into something. That's no longer the case. Egypt has deteriorated throughout the past 30 years dramatically on all fronts, whether it's not only the political stagnation of the Mubarak regime, but it also declined in the role that it played in the regional affairs, surpassed by countries like Qatar and Saudi Arabia, now by the UAE. Others have come up and played that role in the region, leading it with the various directions. The current situation in Egypt is an Egypt that's divided. It's divided along political lines. There's a fight for the soul of Egypt. And a country that's being torn apart between two groups is hardly one capable of projecting power or influence abroad. Egypt is today dependent on Gulf countries for economic support, for feeding the Egyptian people themselves. It needs those countries' support. It follows Gulf policies in the situation in Yemen and others. It needs the UAE in order to be involved in the situation in Libya. It has no ties to Hamas or the one representative or one group within Palestine. Historically, the Egyptian regime has been able to play the role of peacemaker between Israel and between Hamas and other terrorist organizations in Gaza. Nowadays, that's no longer possible. Egypt is no longer able to be the peacemaker between them. So on all four fronts, I think the ability of Egypt to project power abroad has decreased.
But Dr. Traeger, there's an argument to be made, isn't there, that that in facing the regional security threats, Egypt is playing a more assertive role. How can, when Mr. Tedros talks about the fight for the soul of Egypt, how does the kill or be killed struggle that you describe influence all of the other decision making? And can Egypt move, does that kill or be killed struggle continue until there is a clear victor? Or have we already reached that point and we're seeing that in the actions that Egypt has been taking on regional security?
Well, look, I mean, I think the kill or be killed struggle really refers to the domestic political situation. Sitting here 6,000 miles away, my sense, and perhaps your sense as well, is that it has been settled. I mean, President Sisi has, for the most part, in the government, vanquished the Muslim Brotherhood, but the fact that you have the rise in IED attacks, the fact that you have the Muslim Brotherhood's official language towards the regime becoming much more violent, talking about martyrdom and jihad, I think means that that struggle is going to continue, and it's going to be very hard to move or encourage the domestic politics to move in a more positive direction. Now, how that hinges on the regional level, it means that Egypt is going to be more aggressive, and President Sisi has spoken about this, against radical Islamic groups, particularly jihadis. The Egyptian role in Yemen, though, is slightly different. There, Egypt is trying to protect Bab al-Mandab, which is the strait that leads to the Red Sea, that leads to the Suez Canal. The Suez Canal is a major source of revenue for Egypt. So, for now, the Egyptian operation there is limited, and I suspect that Egypt will actually play a slightly more conservative role, certainly a more active role in the region than previous governments, but a more conservative role than we would expect. It's focusing primarily on strait access in Bab al-Mandab, and it's focusing on countering jihadis from Libya. I don't personally expect Egypt to send ground troops into Yemen. They may send, to Saudi Arabia to protect the border, but maybe I'll be proven wrong here, but I don't think that we're going to see a significant Egyptian military role beyond those kind of more narrow interests.
Dr. Kell, I'm out of time, but I hope as we go forward, you'll have a chance to talk about the extent to which Egypt will or will not be able to exert a greater role in the region while some of the domestic issues are continue to be hashed out. But for now, I'll yield back.
Mr. Rohrabacher is recognized.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman. And again, thank you for holding this hearing today and drawing our attention to a country and a struggle that is vital not only to that country, but to, in the long run, to the rest of that region and to the world and to the people of the United States. I believe it is just that historic an event that we're looking at that if we do not do what's right could lead to a historic catastrophe in the sense of the instability and the bloodshed that it could create on a global scale, because if Egypt, as I mentioned earlier, if Egypt falls to radical Islam, the other countries in the Gulf, with their enormous wealth and power, would be transferred to a radical Islamic goal, which would be a catastrophe for our country and for the Western civilization and for the people of that region. So I say Egypt is now playing a positive role, even though it's less of a role in that region, because it's taking care of their business at home. Are we being as supportive as we should be to President El-Sisi in his efforts to, number one, create a stable Egypt, and number two, make sure that Egypt has the weapons and the equipment necessary to play a positive role in that region? And I could have a short answer from each of the witnesses on that.
Well, thank you very much. I mean, I think that we could be doing more in terms of, expressing our partnership with Egypt on certain strategic issues. I think in terms of validating the domestic political trajectory, that should be a bridge too far for us. We have reasonable concerns about the political trajectory there, the repression. There are very reasonable concerns about whether that will, actually help the situation. I do think we have a very limited ability to shape that. So I would urge Congress to urge the administration to move forward with a strategic dialogue with Egypt to get the aid and military-to-military relationship back on track.
Let me note from that answer, President El-Sisi has not received the weapons that he was expecting. We just recently obtained some helicopters from the United States and find out that they did not have the defensive measures on the helicopters that were necessary for them to be used to thwart a radical Islamic insurgency or some kind of an attack out in the Libyan end of their country. That's disgraceful on our part, Madam Chairman, to give weapon systems that he can't even use. It's a slap in his face, as well as the spare parts for the tanks that his country needs if there's a problem especially out in the Libyan end of his country. This is outrageous, and the fact that the Russians have come in and given Assisi some support, here's where I disagree with my colleagues. I think that's a good thing that the Russians are helping President El-Sisi, and I think that we should take that into consideration on how we judge Russia instead of considering it always the enemy of the United States. Sir, would you like to answer the first question about are we playing the supportive role we should be?
Certainly. As the congressman has mentioned, Egypt is important, not because it will play a regional role, but because the fate of Egypt should be a concern to the United States, a country of 90 million people, a country that borders Israel, that is in control of the Suez Canal. For all those reasons, the U.S. needs to be actively involved in investing in Egypt's future, making sure that Egypt does not fall to the same regional upheaval that has taken so many countries there. But this is not only limited to military investment in Egypt's future, bolstering its military capabilities against the security threats, but also investing in Egypt's development, in Egypt's other challenges, in Egypt's rule of law, in building Egyptian institutions that are representatives of their citizens, that are welcomed by their citizens, that is a venue for their citizens to bring about their concerns to their leadership in order for that country not to collapse the same way as other countries have. Unfortunately, the United States has not been doing that. For so long, the administration has been tied to this question of, was it a coup or was it not a coup? What do we do with the military aid? And has forgotten about the other aspects of the relationship, that it's not only about the military aid, but about other things as well.
Very good answer. Could we have a quick answer, Madam Chairman, with the indulgence of me, our last witness, have a her comment on that?
Thank you. I think one issue to clarify right here is that so far the conversation is limited to government-to-government relationship. However, as President Obama mentioned in his speech after the Egyptian uprising and said, it is time to stand on the right side of history and side with the people, this has not translated into actual policies because right now it is confined between military-to-military relationship without actual engagement with the Egyptian people. And this is, Madam Chairman, answers your question about the reputation of the United States within the sentiments of the Egyptian people, because they did not actually feel that there's real engagement. And this can only happen and translate into actual policies when there are support and finances and resources that are channeled towards the civil society organizations that represent the people. The other point, just to say very briefly, that with the changing leadership in Egypt in terms of the personality of the president, there are beyond that inherent structural challenges for the Egyptian state itself. The institutions that actually suffered under Mubarak have not actually undergone real structural reforms. And I'm speaking here about the police, the security sector, and the judiciary itself. And it has, as we've seen, the same even particular people who were drafting the laws under Mubarak are the same people who were drafting the laws under Morsi and until today. And this needs to change to actually lead to real structural change and development. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Rohrabacher. Mr. Connolly.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Dr. Traeger, I mentioned sort of three areas it seems to me we need to be concerned about with respect to Egypt, but backing up just a little bit, you indicated, and as you may know, our State Department has said that the Muslim Brotherhood, led by Morsi, won a free and fair election. Now, if the United States is going to have credibility in the region in encouraging others to move toward a democratic form of government, our tacit support for a military overthrow of a duly elected government, albeit one we felt was on the wrong track and guilty of some serious missteps with respect to writing a constitution, protecting minority rights, and the like. Nonetheless, doesn't that sort of damage our credibility in the region as we try to encourage others to move in a democratic path?
Thank you for your question. I would argue that the credibility of democracy in the region, unfortunately, doesn't rest on our statements and our policies. It frankly rests on the performance of those who are elected. And Morsi's failure in power, the fact that he used an election to grab more power through an edict that he rammed through a very controversial Islamist constitution, that he failed economically, that the Muslim Brotherhood mobilized its cadres to attack protesters, that he tried to crack down on media, and that the country was really sliding into an abyss and frankly still has many, many challenges. I would argue that all of those things significantly undermined the credibility of democracy within Egypt, and it's very hard for us to rescue that from here. And I say that, by the way, very sadly.
But would you cite the current military government, albeit elected, as the alternative? I mean, is that a paragon of democratic virtue in the region?
I'm certainly not arguing that it is.
Do you believe that the current government is committed to the rule of law?
I think that there are major challenges regarding the rule of law. I think the current government is faced with significant institutional challenges and the power struggle that has frankly defined Egypt's post-Mubarak trajectory since 2011 is still playing out. And we see that today in tensions between the presidency and the interior ministry and the power of the judiciary. I mean, this is still a regime that is defining itself. I agree with you very much that the trajectory is not democratic. All that I'm arguing is our capacity to shape that is almost non-existent.
Yeah. One of the things I think we should have learned from the overthrow of the Shah of Iran is that when you don't allow the creation of political space, then you can't be surprised at the rise of an element we don't like. Because in the case of Egypt, years of repression of the political space, it seems to me, made the Muslim Brotherhood the only alternative to the regime, and nothing in between particularly, and that's why they won the election. And it seems to me that the current military government, in going all out in this existential battle for survival you referred to, may unwittingly exacerbate the situation we're concerned about by not allowing political space, even NGOs not allowed to function and being pilloried and persecuted for democratic expression of ideals. Your comment on that?
Well, that's clearly, very possible, and it's true that, look, we should be deeply concerned about Egypt's domestic trajectory, and we should be communicating that very, very clearly. I think that the Secretary of State made a huge mistake when he said that Egypt is on a transition towards democracy. That's just not accurate. But at the same time, I think we have to be conservative in what we can expect from Egypt under the current circumstances of a great deal of violence domestically, a deteriorating regional situation. And moreover, we should acknowledge the fact of the past 4.5 years, which is that political change comes from many different sources, but the ultimate decider, for lack of a better word, of that change is the military, and that has been for over 40 years our partner in Egypt.
If the chair would allow just Mr. Tadros or Dr. Okel to also respond to that.
Be happy to. We certainly cannot influence, the United States cannot influence Egypt's relationship or the Egyptian regime's relationship with the Muslim Brotherhood. It can, however, influence other aspects that are not life and death issues to the Egyptian regime. So the fate of former President Morsi is one issue where we cannot comment on or affect, because simply President Sisi realizes that if the Brotherhood ever took power again, it's his life that will be there. He will be the one hanged. There are many other issues on the domestic front where the United States partnering with Egypt can influence these things to a better direction, whether it's talking building the rule of law, building state institutions, representative governments. We might not be able to force them to hold free and fair elections, but we can certainly train the judges better. We can help the police force deal with protests much better without killing protesters. There are many areas that can be worked on.
And if Dr. O'Kill, if you could briefly comment. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Yes, please. I just want to underscore that, again, most of the conversations focus on the physical interactions. I mean, security physically on the ground and limiting the ability of people to physically assemble and demonstrate. Forgoing that this year and age and this time, that the internet plays a very important role, and this cannot be restricted as the ability of the security forces could do in the streets or shooting people dead. And we've seen also cases where if the security is the prime objective that we want to achieve, we've seen cases, for example, that one of the defendants who was just sentenced to death, for example, he was an average, normal, young Egyptian citizen, got radicalized by connection with some of those terror groups, traveled to Syria, got trained there, and came back and participated in an organization who are planning to conduct some terror attacks in just less than 6 months. This is how quick and this is how volatile the situation can be. And this is just one example to give you that if we just follow the security approach, it will not really lead to stability or security. And that opening the space for more alternative narratives to those of the extremist groups, that would actually be the only answer for that to be defeated, both on the cyber battlefield and on the ground. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Weber is recognized.
The gentleman from Virginia always has such good questions. I could sit and listen to him all day, and like a lot of you, I thought I was going to have to. Just a joke, Jerry, just a joke. y'all didn't respond to the gentleman in California's comments about him thinking that Russia being involved in helping Egypt was a good thing. Dr. Traeger, what say you?
I mean, I respectfully disagree that Russia strengthening its relationship with Egypt is a good thing. Russia clearly has a very different view of the region than the United States, particularly as it pertains to Iran. And I think that we should be very wary of the Russian-Egyptian relationship improving. We should remember, by the way, that the Egyptian military's supplies are, according to estimates, 52% U.S.-made weapons. Most of the other weapons are Russian-made weapons from the era in which the Soviet Union funded Egypt. So Egypt can pivot to Russia in that sense. It can integrate Russian weapons, and I think that's something that we should be working very hard to prevent.
Is it Tadros or Tate?
Tadros,
Mr. Tadros, what say you?
Yes, I would second what Dr. Traeger has said, both for the effect that a close alliance with Russia would have on Egypt's regional policies, on Iran, on Syria, on other matters, but also the possibility of a Russian model in Egypt is not something that anyone should be looking for.
Dr. O'Kale?
Yeah, I completely agree with Mr. Tadros and Dr. Traeger. I mean, having losing the opportunity of the United States having this leverage over pushing Egypt towards a direction that aligns with the principles of democracy and freedom that is like valued in the United States would be a better an ideal position than having to side with Russia.
Sure. Yeah. I think it was you, Mr. Tadros, that said Egypt has no Palestinian relationship. Was that
I said that in the past, Egypt had played a role whenever war would break between Hamas and the State of Israel in brokering an agreement, in exchanges of prisoners, in things like this. This relationship is no longer there, as Egypt has dramatically cut its relations with Hamas, so it can no longer play this role of truce or so organizer between the two.
Thank you. I wanted you to clarify that. One of our questions was suggested as popular satirist Bassem Youssef, who's often referred to as the John Stewart of Egypt, having been the brunt of one of his satires. I know who that is. Youssef had his popular political satire show canceled. Now, according to reports, Mr. Youssef is saying that they made this decision to self-censor in an increasingly restrictive media environment. Is that accurate?
I believe it is.
As much as you know about it.
Yes, I believe it is. The Egyptian regime has had a very restrictive notion about what the press should and should not cover. They believe that the completely open press that existed following the Egyptian revolution is something that undermined national security and led to chaos. And thus, they have created restrictions on freedom of the press, of TV programs and others.
Okay. Dr. O'Carroll, did you say that Facebook was playing a role, and is it an increasing role?
Well, definitely, the internet in general is playing an important and effective role. However, still it is very limited. It doesn't affect the entire population, 90 million people. Most of them are living in poverty, and a lot has no access to the internet. And the mainstream media or the traditional media still play an important role. However, just a point about your earlier questions about the media freedom. Another structural problem with the media is not just the political ability or authority to censor the media, but it's also the inability and the lack of resources for independent media to emerge. And that's a huge problem for many of the voices that needs a platform to democratically voice their.
Let me go real quickly to my last question. Is CAIR, C-A-I-R, Council on American Islamic Relations, are they playing a role between the Brotherhood and Sisi? Any kind of role in that?
I don't believe so. There's certainly no reports that I'm aware of that effect.
Yeah, I don't believe that they are. They have been declared a terrorist organization, of course, by Egypt's ally, the United Arab Emirates. So I don't think the Egyptian regime would be open to any talk with them.
Dr. O'Kell, any knowledge?
I'm not sure that it would be able to play a role.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Weber. Mr. Cicilline.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank you to the panelists. I hope that we can all agree that U.S. policy towards Egypt over the past few decades has had some significant flaws. We propped up an unpopular, repressive dictator who abused his people at the expense of his political cronies and watched on the sidelines as the Egyptian people finally rose up against this repressive regime. And as I listen to this testimony and I review the materials that were submitted, I'm becoming even more concerned that we're very quickly forgetting about this past and preparing to repeat history for the sake of stability, as we said over these past many years. My first question to the panel is whether there are any discernible differences between the current policies towards President al-Sisi's government and our previous policies towards the Mubarak regime. Have we learned anything? I understand we've restructured, as we say, our security assistance, but have we truly evaluated the mistakes of the past and adjusted our policies for the future?
Thank you for your question. I would argue here that we are not propping up the current government of Egypt. That government emerged from a series of circumstances that are intrinsic to that country's domestic politics, namely the fallout from the Morsi era and strong popular support for the current type of regime. The second lesson that I think we should draw from the previous 40 years that you referenced, it doesn't necessarily pertain to The extent to which U.S. should or should not, you know, support democracy or privilege the military relationship, but it should be an analytical lesson, which is that the key player in Egypt has been and will likely remain the Egyptian military. And in that sense, the United States has made a wise choice with its partnerships. Now, it's not an uncomplicated relationship. It's a relationship that we should be using to communicate our displeasure with Egypt's current trajectory, and we should in no way whitewash that trajectory. But at the same time, that relationship is very important for U.S. strategy in the region.
Mr. Tadros or Dr. O'Kale?
I think there are differences. As Dr. Traeger mentioned, the United States is not completely supportive of the Sisi regime, the same way that could be said of the earlier period of the Mubarak regime. When President Mubarak took over power in similar circumstances of an Islamist challenge existing following Sadat's assassination, there were no objections from the United States to any policies that Egypt was doing. The administration has highlighted a number of areas of disagreement with the regime and has been publicly expressing its displeasure with a variety of the regime's policies.
Dr. O'Kale?
I agree with Mr. Tadros and Dr. Traeger. But I think the main difference is that the realization that right now, I mean, with the situation under Mubarak is that the United States wanted to make sure that the stability continues and avoid the scare scenario of having the Islamists taking power. Right now, we're not seeing policies that would avoid the repetition of this scenario, because after the fall of Mubarak, there was a vacuum where there are no secular political parties able to organize and run competitively in the elections against the Islamists. Right now, we don't see signs of learning from this lesson, where there are no support for having political parties organized under open and democratic laws that actually allow for them to have the resources and ability to and freedom to organize and be there when and if there is a challenge between them and the Islamists.
So the last two things I want to ask about are the status of preparations for parliamentary elections. Have voters been allowed to register? Are parties and candidates beginning to register? Is there any real indication that these elections will in fact be held this year? And then secondly, what is the current status of press freedom in the country? We've heard a lot about the targeting of users of social media and bloggers, but are there any independent newspapers or TV channels that are operating and are government-run papers and stations still engaged in this persistent kind of smear campaign against civil society and the United States?
Well, the process has already begun in preparing for the elections before the Constitutional Court decision, and registration was underway, and political parties were preparing for the elections. Right now, it's on pause, waiting for the new electoral law, which will actually affect the way those political parties were run and campaign for the elections. And it's very related to your second question about the press freedom, because this is very important. It's the only channel that would reach the masses of the people when they campaign and present themselves to the Egyptian and their voters. Right now, the press is undergoing a lot of restrictions. As I mentioned earlier, there are the political restrictions that actually lead people to either censor themselves or because of the intimidation and fear of the prosecution, but is also the economic restriction, because the new, young, and independent voices, they would have the talent and ability to voice their messages, but they don't have the platform or the economic ability to actually turn that into actual reality. Thank you.
Thank you. I thank the chair, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Cicilline. Dr. Yoho.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's been an interesting meeting here. I appreciate all the information that's come out. I've got a whole list of questions here. The first one is, what is the credibility of the U.S. and Egypt today versus, say, 10 or 15 years ago? Dr. Traeger?
Well, I mean, in terms of the popular perception in Egypt, the popular perception of the United States is significantly diminished because of this perception that the United States is interfering in Egypt's domestic politics. And I want to emphasize that that is not in any way my view.
No, I understand.
But that is the perception, and it is another factor in the reason why it's so hard to influence this country's domestic politics.
Mr. Tedros?
I absolutely agree. The U.S. has no credibility at the moment with either side of the conflict in Egypt. The Muslim Brotherhood supporters believe that it is supporting the regime and vice versa.
Dr. Okeo?
I agree. I mean, the credibility of the United States has usually been undermined throughout the 4 years since the 2011 revolution. And I think, again, that's because the relationship remains a government-to-government relationship without actually transferring and conveying the message to the Egyptian people themselves and addressing their grievances.
Okay, and I talk to people all over the Middle East when they come here, and I hear the same thing. The U.S. has lost its credibility and the goodwill that we've generated over the last 200 years. It's gone. And let me ask you this. Should the U.S. have acknowledged the overthrow of Morsi as a coup? Because I know other nations have, and I think history will record it. And if so, should we have responded in the way our laws say that no foreign aid goes to Egypt? And I bring this up strictly because we've lost our credibility. Our word doesn't mean anything. And if we're a nation of laws and we have these policies in place, if we don't stand by that and acknowledge that, people aren't going to take us seriously. And if we had, it may have changed the outcome in Egypt. They may have thought differently. What's your opinion?
Well, I think U.S. credibility doesn't rest on the terms that we use to refer to events in Egypt. It really hinges on our relationships, and that's really where I think the loss of credibility with the current Egyptian government is. That government asks, where does the United States stand? And the type of hedging that Mr. Tedros referred to has undercut our credibility, not only with the current government, but with both sides, and doesn't hinge so much on what we would have called Morsi's ouster.
Okay, Mr. Tedros, I want to ask you a separate question. Since Morsi was elected by the people democratically, would that have changed what we see today if we would have announced that as a coup and say we stand with a democratic process because we're promoting democracy? And since he was democratically elected, should we have intervened and said, you can't do that, that's a coup? I mean, what is your opinion on that?
I don't believe it would have influenced the decision of the Egyptian military. The Egyptian people, there were mass protests in Egypt. People were fed up with the Muslim Brotherhood rule for a variety of reasons. And U.S. Words would not have stopped the country's movement in that direction.
The Arab Spring would have happened anyways. Dr. O'Kale, I have a question for you. If Morsi has his death sentence carried out, what do you see happening in Egypt and the neighboring countries?
Well, I don't believe they actually will execute the death sentence. However, of course, there will be a lot of concerns. Just after the verdict on Saturday, there were 20 terror attacks, and there is most likely in reaction to the verdict. Again, with the interconnectivity of the transnational connection between the groups, it may trigger versus coordinated attacks and have like dire effects in general. However, we're not sure how would that like fare out.
Okay. And then I want to build on Mr. Rohrabacher's and Mr. Weber's question about Russians' help in that region. I heard what you're saying. From our perspective, what is the perspective in Egypt? What are they saying? Is Russia welcome there? And looking at that, Dr. Traeger?
Well, ahead of this kind of warming of relations with Russia, the Egyptian media started speaking very, very favorably of Russia, very favorably of Putin. And I think the popular view in Egypt is that Russia is an uncomplicated relationship because they could buy weapons from Russia and Russia won't worry about the democratic issues that we're rightly raising here today. There is one problem with that analysis within Egypt, which is that Russia isn't giving these weapons away for free. It's not offering offering the type of aid the United States is offering, but certainly in the short run, Egypt is able to find other funds for buying Russian weapons, and they've shown that they can replace the United States, at least in these short-term withholdings.
All right, I have one more question, but I'm out of time. Okay, thank you, Madam Chair. Whoever wants to answer this, is a democracy possible without property rights acknowledged by a government and the protection of human rights as we believe here, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, you know, with, you know, the freedom of religion, freedom of speech? Do you see that possible in a country where we keep trying to promote a democracy without that government acknowledging those rights?
Well, at least the 30 years rule of Mubarak proved that this is not possible. That
I agree.
I mean, the entire assumptions upon which Mubarak was supported is that he is able to maintain stability, and the human rights violation and the closure of the political space could be overlooked for the sake of security and stability. But it was proven that after like three decades of strong rule, he fell in only 18 days. So,
right.
I mean, nothing would be maintained. Security solutions are essential and important, but they're not sustainable without real structural changes.
I agree. Is anybody else miss?
Yeah, if I may add, no, democracy cannot be sustained without property rights, without religious freedom. And this is why the United States should not only focus on the question of holding elections, as important as this is, but on building institutions,
exactly,
the rule of law, property, economic freedom, and others.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yoho. Ms. Frankel.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is a very interesting discussion, and I've taken both sides of these issues so many times, but it just seems to me that the Arab Spring has turned into a very, very cold winter all over the world. And I think it's quite obvious that you cannot snap your fingers and get democracy and freedom and end repression. And as much as that is our values here, and we would like to see that happen, what it sounds to me like what is happening is that we have you can just tell from all the questions here, there is this conflict between whether or not is it security versus democracy. So a couple questions. First of all, can you say what do you think is in our sphere of influence and what is not? And where should our priorities be? Should it be the security of the region? I mean, what, maybe you could mention, this is an elementary question, but why is it important, or do you think it's important that Egypt be stable? And should we maybe sacrifice or turn our head on what are obvious human right abuses in order to have security? And I'd like to know, if you have time, whether you think there's a threat of ISIL or any other terrorist situation coming into Egypt. And finally, Madam Chair, I know I'm, so if there is time.
No problem.
Whether this coup law, I call it the coup law, needs to be changed, because it just seems to me that we are just playing with words or having to play with words in defining what happened in Egypt when el-Sisi took over.
Well, just in terms of what is and is not in our sphere of influence, you know, my view is that the role of foreign policy is primarily to shape the way states behave externally, and that it's often difficult to shape the way states behave internally, and that's certainly the case in the current situation in Egypt, where you have the government and the Muslim Brotherhood locked in a kill or be killed struggle, one that the current government is winning, but one that is likely to continue in some shape or form for a while. And we can influence Egypt's external relations if we reinforce the military-to-military relationship, if Congress urges the administration to move forward with a strategic dialogue with the Egyptian government. And there are many areas areas in which Cairo and Washington can better coordinate, for example, in Libya. The administration and Cairo are on very different pages there. Egypt has been the target of attacks that we believe emanate from the instability in Libya. It's responded reportedly by launching airstrikes in coordination with the UAE and was criticized by the administration for that, which doesn't really help the relationship because from Egypt's perspective, they are attacking imminent threats. So we need to better coordinate our policy on Libya. And frankly, we could be doing a lot to help bolster Egypt's counterterrorism in the Sinai. That also requires the Egyptian government approving that. They have been a little bit resistant to that as the relationship has fallen on difficult times. But I think by reinvigorating the relationship, we might be able to get on the same page there as well.
I would slightly disagree. I think our sphere of influence of the United States is not only limited to foreign affairs, but also to domestic ones, as long as those areas are not life-threatening to President Sisi or the regime. The United States in the past has helped Soviet Jews, despite that being a domestic affair in the Soviet Union. It was able to influence the fate of those people because it was not a life-threatening issue. In those areas where the regime claims or proclaims its willingness to work on them, such as religious freedom, we should hold it to task and ask it to take meaningful steps and not just symbolic gestures. President Sisi should be encouraged to pass a law to allow the building of churches in Egypt. That's not something that threatens the stability of the country as a whole. In terms of the ISIS threat, I think on the long run, the threat from the Sinai is likely to be contained. The more alarming threat would be the growth of or the spread of violence from Libya in Egypt. The Western Desert is the area that voted most heavily for an Islamist candidate in all successive elections. It's 1,000 kilometers of borders with Libya, free flow of weapons from there, tribal ties to the tribes of Libya. There are many elements there that would make a potential insurgency there much more threatening than the Sinai.
Can Dr. O'Kale answer, Madam Chair?
No problem.
Sorry. There is certainly a threat from ISIL to Egypt, and as I mentioned in my testimony, there is already one terror group, Ansar Beit al-Maqdis, have declared their loyalty to ISIS, and they got the blessing from their leader. At the same time, there are several Egyptians who travel to Iraq, Syria, and Libya to fight there. Some of them come back home. We don't have actual numbers and information about how many they are, but they are definitely a real and existential threat to the security in the country. As for your question concerning the support for human rights and whether we can forego that for security, I don't think that they are mutually exclusive. I think they complement each other. And with regards to your related questions about what's in the sphere of the United States is already providing the needed support for in terms of the military assistance. However, there is so much that can be done, particularly with regards to education reform, health support, rule of law, because so far most of the relationship and the policies targets towards Egypt, not just from the United States, but foreign policy in general, is having a very short-term view. When we look at the region, and when you look at Egypt in particular, out of the 90 million people, a huge percentage of this are youth under 25 years old. These are the ones that we would like to invest in so that we would not be faced in a situation where in the next elections, people would be told that if they vote for a particular party, they will be voting for God, and people will buy into that and support that. So we would like to avoid a situation of short-term policies and have long-term vision and investment in the actual people who will be shaping the future of the country.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Frankel. Mr. Boyle.
Well, thank you, and first I just want to say specifically to Dr. Okel, as one of the 43 NGO workers who physically was captured and jailed for the work that you were doing, I just great admire and deeply respect your work and the sacrifices that you yourself made. My question is something regarding very specific and very recent. I was very concerned with not just Morsi, but over 100 now being sentenced from the political opposition to death, to execution. And while certainly no fan whatsoever of the Muslim Brotherhood or of Morsi, my question is, A, what does the timeline seem like in terms of the executions, particularly with Morsi? And then number two, to what extent could this have a destabilizing effect? Because you only need to look at other historical examples of executions end up triggering a response in the population that ends up having a destabilizing effect. So with those two questions.
Thank you so much for your kind words. I really appreciate it. Concerning the executions, I would like to put this into the broader context. These are not the first death sentence that were issued. There were hundreds before, and for a variety of factions and people. And there are thousands of people who are in prison. Whether these sentences will be actually implemented and executed or not, this has remained to be seen. Highly likely they will not be. However, actually this is another concerning point, because the fact that there are verdicts that are being issued and people have the knowledge and the acknowledgement that they will not be executed, this is an undermining of the rule of law as itself, as a tool for justice, and turning it from a tool to justice into a tool for intimidation, which will actually harm the future of the Egyptian sphere of political development, social and economic justice that people would like to see, and having the law performing its role and rather become highly politicized and highly and more increasingly used as a tool of intimidation rather than a tool for justice. Thank you.
I believe from the Egyptian government's stand or point of view, they believe that passing those death sentences against such symbolic figures as President Morsi, as the former or the leader of the Brotherhood, General Gaid Badia, and others, they're sending a message that there are no red lines, that previous Egyptian governments had shied away from arresting people like the General Gaid, that even Nasser in his repression did not hang the General Gaid. The message from the government is that we're in this until the end. We are willing to take all necessary steps. And from their point of view, they believe that this might discourage some people from taking up arms and violence now that they realize that there are no red lines completely.
I agree with what's been said. I would just add that we also have to understand the death sentences in terms of the ongoing power struggle, specifically in this case, between the judiciary and the Muslim Brotherhood. That goes back almost 2 years, actually almost 3 years, excuse me. And so I think the sentences, pertain to that, which is not in any way a justification, just reinforcing that this is an ongoing power struggle within the country that is very, very hard to shape from 6,000 miles away.
It would be, and I would just conclude with this, and thank you, Madam Chair. It would be ironic if after all of this and a so-called Arab Spring and all of this tumult, what ends up emerging in Egypt is a fairly pro-Western autocratic leader that isn't very fond of the rule of law or human rights. Sounds a lot like a guy named Mubarak that was in power for three decades. It would be a bitter irony if after all of this, that's what essentially we're left with. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Boyle, thank you. And we certainly view Egypt as a strong and important ally, and striking that balance between security and democratic reforms. We hope they find that sweet spot. Thank you so much. Subcommittee is adjourned.